All right, so we're going to take a look at the Foxeer Falkor. Power it up real quick, and you should have an image on screen. Now, I have reset the camera to defaults. I haven't really taken the time to tweak the settings and see what might or might not work better. But there's a little bit of flight footage coming up at the end of this video, and that was all flown on the defaults besides turning off the OSD. So let's get into it now. As you can see, the camera's live, it's working. A couple of things to note. The OSD, the first thing I noticed right off the bat, the OSD, which you can see at the bottom of the screen, you have the pilot name, a voltage, which is not connected, so it's going to read 0 volts, and then you have a timer, which is right there. That's basically just a power on timer. Starts when you power the camera up, and it runs until you disconnect the power. But like I said, the first thing I noticed is there's no border around the text for the OSD. So as you can see on my notebook right here, it's kind of a white background. It's a little bit harder to see. If it was a little bit brighter white, obviously it would be more of an issue, which you may run into when you're flying. But as you can see, against a slightly darker background, something like this, it's gonna show up just fine. But it's not a deal breaker, obviously, just one of the minor things that I noticed. And right over here in this area, right over here, you notice this little bit of digital artifacting. That sort of comes and goes, and that's when I have it connected directly to my capture card. And which capture card you can see right over here, it's a little USB capture device, and I have my camera just plugged straight directly into it, not through a transmitter or anything like that. I did not see that in the air. As you can see, it's kind of worse. It comes and goes, it's better and worse at times. Now, I'm not sure if that's an issue between the camera and the capture device, if it's just like an incompatibility or something like that, because like I said, I never saw it when I had the camera in the air yesterday. So I just thought I should point that out. Wanted to point it out. So let's get into the menus now. And once again, one thing I noticed right off the bat, if you go all the way down, you see you have save and exit right here. If I go down once more, the cursor disappears. There's actually another line below this, which is just save without, just exit without save. And if you keep going, it'll scroll back around to the top. But the bottom of that OSD menu gets cut off. And that happens on all of my displays, unless I connect it directly to one of my little LCD TV screens, which is that one sitting right there. It's a little hair 10-inch screen. If I connect the camera directly to it and run it in PAL mode, because that display does support PAL, then the menu shows up correctly. But using NTSC, which I am right now, obviously, then the bottom of the menu gets cut off. So just wanted to point that out. So we'll run through the menus right now. First option you have is auto exposure. And in that menu, you have brightness, exposure mode, and advanced. Personally, I think the camera is a little bit too bright on the default setting of 10. We'll run it all the way up. You can see it actually gets quite high and washed out before it resets all the way back to zero, which makes the camera go crazy, as you can see here. But if you bump it up to 1, well, actually, earlier it was acting right on 1, but maybe now it's not. Okay, so I guess you got to go up to 2. But if you set it, okay, now it's working right on 1. But if you go all the way down to 0, it kind of, I guess it's auto exposure algorithm, whatever, gets tripped up and does not seem to work well at all. So never set it that low, basically. But personally, I think it's a little bit too bright after flying it. I might bump this down 1 or 2 numbers, but right now we're gonna leave everything on defaults. Like I said, I haven't really taken the time to tweak settings and stuff like that. But the exposure mode default is wide dynamic range, obviously. And if you set that to globe, you notice in wide dynamic range there's a lot of noise, and especially in darker areas like the back of the chair right over there, and below the table right under there. A lot of that goes away when you set it on whatever this globe is. You see the picture is also a lot softer. Notice the in the pegboard in the background, little holes, you can kind of make those out. In globe, that completely just goes away. You lose a lot of detail and obviously your wide dynamic range. So the wide dynamic range is introducing a lot of noise into the picture, but it's the only mode that seems to work well enough to actually use it for flying. So we're going to leave that on wide dynamic range. And in advanced, you can change your shutter control from auto or manual. And once again, once you play around with the shutter settings, it kind of trips the camera up and it doesn't seem to work right. And also, once you go back to auto, you lose color for some reason. The picture looks terrible until you play with your gain control. Then it will come back and act normal. So once again, gain control, you have auto or manual. And on manual, you can change your gain. You can see the effect there. We're just going to leave that on auto. Or what was your other setting? Your digital gain? Not sure what that one is. Doesn't seem to have much effect. But we'll leave it on auto. So your next option in the menu is white balance. And trying to get comfortable here. Your white balance, you have auto white balance, or you can set that to manual. Then you have your red, blue, and no green, I guess. You balance red and blue to match the green. But we're going to leave it on auto. When I flew it yesterday, the auto white balance seemed to work fine, so we'll leave that alone. Day and night, you have auto or always color, always black and white, or an external trigger. Or we'll leave it on auto. Now, speaking of the auto day and night, if I just cut my hand around the lens and completely block out the light, you can see it will switch to black and white, but it does get rather noisy, grainy image. And it does switch rather quick, as you can see there. But one thing I noticed, if you block enough light to get it to switch, you can kind of get the camera into this oscillation where it switches back and forth between color and black and white without really sticking to one option or the other. And a lot of cameras in auto mode, you can set that trigger point to and a delay to get it to not do that. There's no option to adjust auto mode here, so that may be an issue if you're gonna fly in low light. I can see that becoming an issue. In that case, you would probably want to come and either set it to stick to color, which you can see here, it's just gonna never switch and looks fine, everything works fine. And honestly, I don't see a lot of difference other than some color noise, obviously, in the low light. Or you could set it to black and white, but personally, I don't like the image in black and white. You can see it really does get rather grainy and noisy. Maybe my opinion would change if I flew it in some low light, but just testing indoors here. I think I would probably leave it in full color mode unless I need it black and white for low light. But my opinion so far, based on what I've seen, is it's not going to be an excellent low light camera. There's probably some better options out there. So we may play around with that later. But for now, we're leaving it on defaults on auto. And image enhance menu, you have contrast, auto, or you can set it to manual and adjust the value. Sharpness, same thing. And also the color gain, and also your noise reduction. And I did notice, I played around with this a little bit earlier, you can see zero noise reduction set on manual. You can see, and especially in the, like I said, in the darker areas like the back of this chair and over under the desk right over there, you see there's a lot of noise. And if we bump that all the way up to the highest value, to number 30, it kind of takes some of that noise out, but it's not completely gone. But you'll notice you do get kind of a ghosting effect. You notice like the edge of the desk right over here. When I tilt the camera up and down, you see that kind of ghosting effect. If you set that to no noise reduction, you have none of that ghosting effect. So if we just leave it on auto, it's kind of a nice balance between the noise level and slight ghosting. But I did notice that. Thought I should probably point it out. So we'll leave that alone. And your video setting. Here you can switch between NTSC and PAL. But like I said, my recorder does not support PAL. So I'm going to leave it on NTSC. HD format is CVBS. I'm not sure what that is. I can't even change it. It doesn't have any effect on anything. So we're not going to worry about it. And your special setting. This is where you can switch between 4:3 and 16:9. So we're going to switch it to 16:9, and which causes the camera to reboot. Now in 16:9 mode, I'm going to set this pin here where it's just visible at the bottom of the frame there. Now if we go back into special settings menu and switch it back to 4:3, you can see you actually gain a little bit of frame down at the bottom and also at the top. So we can repeat the same thing and take note of the top of the frame. You see the top of the frame here, right over here, we kind of cut in the corner of this little window off right here. So if we go back into the special settings menu and switch it back to 4:3, you can see not only do you get the rest of that window frame, but you also get a little bit more area in the top of your frame right up here. You see the Skywalker hanging from the ceiling right up there. So 4:3 mode, you're going to get the full image sensor, and 16:9 is cutting off the top and the bottom of the frame. So in fact in my last video, the first look video for this, someone asked about taking the lens out and seeing what kind of sensor was inside. Based on this test, I think it's going to be a 16:9 sensor. I think it's going to be a 4:3 sensor, and 16:9 mode is just cropping it down, and you're losing the top and bottom of the frame. So I will open the camera up and verify that, and I'll probably put a picture on screen now. But I believe it's going to be a 4:3 sensor. So everything else in here is your name. Open means on, close means off. For your name, voltage, and timer, which are components of your OSD. So far, I haven't actually found a way, at least not in this menu, to edit any of these. You should be able to edit your name, obviously, but voltage is just a voltage. I don't think there's a low voltage warning. Obviously, I haven't seen it blink or anything, not connected, showing 0 volts. It doesn't warn that the voltage is low, but there may be a setting to turn that on. We'll investigate a little bit further in just a minute. And timer. Now you do have some presets here. It comes default on sunset, and you also have sunny, cloudy, indoor, and back to sunset. Now sunset, I don't see any difference in the image when I change these, and if I hit enter on each one, it doesn't really seem to take effect. So we're going to go from sunset to sunny, and we're going to leave it on that, and I'm going to save and exit, and no, it still has no effect. So I'm not sure if that option is maybe just broken, or I don't know, it doesn't seem to have any effect on my camera at least. But that's that. So like I said, then you have different language options here, is the only other setting. So we're gonna leave it on English. And you can reset your default settings here, or save and exit, or like I said, that bottom option that you can't see is exit without saving. So we're just gonna save and exit. So let's investigate with the OSD, see if we can configure it. I'm gonna press and hold the left button. And nothing's happening, so let us press and hold the top button. Same, nothing happening. Press and hold the right button. There's still nothing happening. Press and hold the bottom button, and nothing happens. So let's try press and hold the middle button, and there we go. I don't know what this is, actually. It's rather strange little menu here, and I'm not sure what's going on here. This little little icon here is, looks like it's like maybe a progress indicator, but I have no idea what's going on with any of this. Let me see if I press left, right, up, down, nothing happens. Press the middle button. We go back into the normal menu. So let's exit without saving. So let me press and hold that button again. Press up, down, right, left. Maybe press and hold again. Same thing. So yeah, I don't know how to edit your name or what that other weird menu is. Let me go name. If I press enter, nothing happens. Maybe if I press hold, enter, no, nothing happens. Press and hold left, nothing happens. Press and hold right, nothing happens. So yeah, I don't really see a way to edit the name. But we can, like I said, you can switch those off. And if we save and exit, you see the OSD is going away now. One more time, let me press and hold the enter key. And nothing happens now. If you press and hold enter with the OSD options off, nothing happens. So, let me switch those back on then. And once again, if we press and hold, we get this weird little menu. If I press and hold, it does the same thing. So yeah, I mean, your guess is as good as mine. So, a couple of things to note. Picture seems a little bit noisy, a little bit too bright. The wide dynamic range works well. It seems maybe a little bit over sharpened. Maybe we can go in the menu and lower that. Where was that at? And image enhance, sharpness, set it to manual and knock the sharpness down all the way. Image gets kind of blurry, but the noise is still there. Wow, it's really over sharpened if you go on the high end. Around maybe 2 or 3 on manual looks pretty good, but yeah, auto is a little bit sharper than that. But anyway, we're starting to ramble on and make this video longer than it needs to be. Picture is a little bit noisy, a little bit too bright on default. I would probably lower the brightness. It is a little bit noisy, especially on the dark areas like this. And I did notice that in flight as well. In the flight footage at the end, you can probably see when you're looking down at some shadowed areas by the trees and the trees themselves, stuff like that. You'll notice a little bit of noise, a little bit of graininess. But overall, the image looks good. It has pretty good light handling. The sun doesn't wash the camera out at all. It doesn't really blow it out. It handles the sun in the sky without blowing out darker areas. There's not a lot of glare, light glare from the sunlight on the lens. And it was kind of a partly cloudy day. It wasn't really direct sunny sky. But it should be good enough to get an idea of what it's going to look like. White balance worked well. Color balance looked a little bit on the cool side, but overall very good. And like I said, you do have the option for manual white balance if you want to adjust that. I see no way to edit the name on your OSD. And also, most if not all other cameras that I've tried with a built-in OSD, when you do not connect the voltage sense wire to anything, which is how I have it set up right here, obviously it's showing 0 volts, they will usually default over to reading the input power to the camera, which in this case is a 3S LiPo. But obviously this one doesn't do that. It's only going to read what's connected to the voltage sense pin. So if you want to just show the power going to the camera, if you run it straight off your flight battery, then you'll need to tie the power and the voltage sense wires together to get that reading. I wish there was a little border around the OSD to make the text a little bit easier to read on bright backgrounds. And the presets don't seem to work, but so it's not a perfect camera. It seems to be kind of average in the lower end of the price spectrum for high resolution CMOS cameras right now. I would say it's kind of similar to, well, I don't really want to class it together with the Predator and the Monster and the Eagle. And what's the other one I tested recently? The Sparrow, I think, the little purple camera that I liked. I would probably, honestly, I might choose the Sparrow over this one. And the other cameras that I mentioned are probably all a little bit better than this one. But this one is on the low end of the price spectrum at around $40 or a little bit less. So hopefully this will give you a good idea of what it is and what it isn't, and let you decide for yourself if you want it or if you don't. So I guess we'll just kind of get into the flight footage now. Alright, so as you can see, we're taking off, and this is the AR wing flying with iNav that I did a video on recently. But anyway, we're focusing on the camera. Like I said, you can see the colors are reasonably natural, and the white balance is pretty accurate. Everything looks pretty realistic. Maybe slightly on the cool side, and like I mentioned earlier, a little bit bright. As you can see here, looking into the sun, like I said, you do have a pretty decent dynamic range. And there wasn't much glare from the sunlight hitting the camera lens, as you can see there. And in just a bit, I think I turned back into the sun, which we are now. And you see that glare again. Overall, it seems to be reasonably good quality video, if not maybe a little bit grainy. I don't want to say it's the same kind of shimmering over sharpened effect that you get with some of the other high resolution cameras. Namely, the original Eagles were notorious for that. They did improve in later versions. But anyway, we're talking about the Foxeer Falkor today. So it doesn't really look like the same kind of over sharpening effect to me. It's more of just a general graininess. But overall, it's not bad. And especially here, you can see, like I said, it's kind of a little bit on the cool side, a little bit kind of a blue hue to the video. But it's acceptable. And like I said, you do have manual white balance if you want to tune that to your liking. Like I said, we did use auto white balance for this, all the default settings. But it, besides being a little bit on the cool side, it seems stable. It doesn't really hunt like some cameras do in auto white balance. Your white balance is pretty consistent, is what I'm getting at, basically. But other than that, it's a decent camera considering the price range that it's in. But there are better cameras out there. But this one seems pretty reasonable for its price. So that's pretty much all I can say about it for now. If I missed anything, skipped over anything, or if there's anything else you would like to see, maybe drop a comment below. I'll try to get to it if I can. I do want to point out that RCSchim has one of these, and I believe he said he's already filmed his review, or started filming it. So expect that to come out soon. I'll drop a link to his channel below, because he always does some really good latency testing, which is the one thing I noticed when playing this one on the workbench. It does seem to have a noticeable latency. But I'm not 100% sure if that's my recording setup. So like I said, I have changed a lot of things in my software configuration recently. But it did seem to have a little bit more latency than other cameras that I've used with the same setup. So I look forward to his testing and his findings. I hope he does a latency test. Like I said, I can't verify for sure whether he will or not, but I think he will. And if he will, and if he does, just go ahead and check that out. So I hope this video was helpful, and if you're not already subscribed to my channel, please do so, and be sure to hit the bell notification icon, and stay tuned for more stuff to come in the future.